We are in Revelation chapter 2 as we start moving now to the phase of the churches. Last week we looked at verse 19 of chapter 1 where John says, write the things which you have seen, which are things which are, and which the things that should be hereafter. And of course the things that he had seen was the resurrected Christ there in chapter 1. As you see the Lord there as it describes what John was able to see at that time. The things that are, what's right now is the churches, the age of the churches. And so we're to be looking at it in chapter 2 and chapter 3. The various churches not only were there during the time John wrote this, but even are represented even to this day. And then the things which are after hereafter, or metatelta, as we mentioned here last week, would be after what things? After the things of the church, when the church is done and moved up to where? The church will be moving to heaven real soon. And so the attention, the rest of the chapter, well, it'll go a couple chapters of the activity of heaven, but eventually in chapter 6, it'll start dealing with what happens when the church is removed, which is known as the 7 years of tribulation. And so we'll be spending a lot of chapters on the hereafter, or the metatelta. In chapter 2, what we get here is the Church of Ephesus. Really, I like to call it the neglected priorities, as we're looking at here, the neglected priority. If I would take a look at what was happening there in Ephesus, I'll just read the 7 verses and then we'll look at it a little closer. Unto the angel of the Church of Ephesus write, these things saith he that holdeth the 7 stars in his right hand, who walketh in the midst of the 7 golden candlesticks. He says, I know thy works and thy labor, thy patience, and how thou cannot bear them which are evil, and hast tried them which say that they are apostles and are not, and have found them liars, and has borne, it has patience, and for my name's sake it has labored and has not fainted. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou hast fallen, repent, and do thy first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and will remove thy candlestick out of its place, except thou repent. But this thou hast, thou hatest the deeds of Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcome, will I give him to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. A little bit of background, of course, what was going on there in Ephesus. It was called the Metropolitan of Asia. It was a seaport, a capital of Asia Minor, really what it was. And it was the largest city of the traditional business that they had. And it was just tremendous. Misa and I, one of my travels, I was up there and I was able to go into this town of Ephesus. But of course, it's no longer by the water anymore, because the silt had gone into the harbor, had filled it up, and there, it's almost, I would say, a mile or so down to the harbor, which once was. It had really these tremendous pagan city. Of course, it was the temple of Artemis, and Diana was one of the, you remember those little statues they used to worship, was this multi-breasted, really colossal statue. The goddess of sex and fertility is what they worship. They had an amphitheater, 25,000 people back then. They had this great library, and the structure of the library is still there. And it's pretty impressive when you walk down the main street and you see this huge library. One of the wonders of the world, they said, was this library, and really was the cultural city of the empire. The estimated population varied from 250,000 people living there to 500,000. Like I said, when we were there, I don't think Miss was on this trip. When I was there, she was. There in that amphitheater where Paul the Apostle spoke, I also spoke and I taught what Paul was teaching on that right there. And I was in this tremendous amphitheater. I just sometimes look at the construction of those and how they did it back then. The Church of Ephesus has its root in a brief visit in the synagogue by Paul the Apostle in Acts chapter 18. You could read that. A ministry by Apollos also was there in Acts chapter 18, who was taught by Aquilas and Priscilla. You remember that, Aquilas and Priscilla? Well, it all took place there in this town, an encounter by Paul with 12 disciples, and it goes on. So you find Paul there doing a lot of different things. There was a great revival in the city, really because it was dominated by the occult. And sometimes we lose sight of what the occult's doing, even in our society. But Paul confronted it, and there was a tremendous riot there in the amphitheater in Acts chapter 19. I'm going to be showing you or teaching on six different things that we see on this. I'm borrowing a little few things from Pastor Chuck and a few things from our friend David Hawking and a few things from me that in this study as we go through it. I want to read the six things that we look at it. First of all, the centrality and control of Jesus Christ our Lord in verse 1. The commendation that Jesus gives to the church in verses 2 through 3 and also in verse 6. The concern Jesus Christ had for his church in verse 4. The challenges to the church in verse 5. And the consequences which the church faces if it does not repent also in verse 5. And finally, the comfort which the Lord gives to individual. So that, first of all, the centrality and control of Jesus Christ our Lord in verse 1. We read, unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven candlesticks. He walks in the midst of the church. If I could picture that, he's walking right down the aisle right here. He's walking right in the midst of Agape Chapel here to minister to his sheep. We'll be talking more about that Sunday morning, but he's here to tend in the care. As he tells us the centrality of Jesus Christ, where he says he walks in the midst. You know, that's what it should be about. Church should always be about what? Jesus. Plain and simple. Not about, you know, how many great treats we're going to have. I was at a place the other night, and they were so excited about how they were having they were doing some polka dance in the other room or some dance. And I was getting ready to go teach at this other thing going on at the church. And they say, come in with us. We have so much fun. We do polka or whatever. And I was thinking, well, we have more fun. We teach the Bible. Come with us, you know. But they caught me off guard. And it's amazing how we lose Jesus as being the center of what we are, you know, what we give. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with the church's activities and all they do. As long as we in a church, that a church does church things, that the person of Jesus is glorified. And then also we see the control. I love this about it. He that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, he's in control of what happens at Agape Chapel. Not me. I can't make it happen. We can't make it happen. It takes the Holy Spirit to make it what it wants. Neglecting priorities are the result of taking our eyes off of Jesus, isn't it? Who is the head of the church and one who controls all things. We need to keep our eyes on the Lord. Please pray for us here at Agape Chapel that we would always keep him front and center of all that we do and all that we say. He says the first and foremost activity of any church or objective of any church is the worship and the praise of Jesus Christ. That's what's first. that even though through the teaching as we come to learn about Jesus, the ultimately should be that we should pray and that we should draw close and that we should worship him throughout our weeks and the things that we do. Are we expressing that love and loyalty to him? Is our priorities right that we look to sing? You know, you guys all know how to sing songs. If you were around Calvary Chapel at all for a little bit of time, especially with Pastor Chuck, as Michael mentioned him earlier, we would sing these songs over and over and over. And I asked Pastor Chuck one day, why do you do that? Why do you just keep singing these, you know, same songs with some musicians? Oh, I got to have a different set. I got to have a different set. But he sings the same one. He says, because I want them to learn them. And they stick like, you know, like what he calls stick to our ribs, you know, where it's not going to go away very easy. And so sure enough, this many years today, I was driving around and what was you know, bubbling up was, oh, that's out of key. You know, but in the car, it sounded really good, you know, but I would start singing them. And that's what it is that Jesus is the center and really the centrality and his control of the church. Second thing that you notice is the condemnation that Jesus gives to the church in verses 2 through 3 and verse 6. He says, first of all, I know thy works and thy labor and thy patience and how thou canst not bear them which are evil. And I like that. And thou hast tried them which say that they're apostles and are not, and hast found them liars. And has borne, and has patient, and for my sake has labored and has not fainted. Drop down to verse 6. But this thou hatest, thou hatest the deeds of the I almost said the Nicolaitans, but that's not it. Which I also hate. He says these guys were a group of people, the Nicolaitans, which he hated. Jesus hates. We're a group of people that really did prosper in the third century that were, but actually born in the first, who were reproved in the Bible, as we see. They were a follower of this guy named Nicholas, one of the first seven deacons ordained by the apostle, but he went sideways. And he says, according to the Bible, these guys taught that was not acceptable to practice. They thought it was okay to have adultery in this church. Was very prevalent. Remember in the church of Corinth, that Paul had to deal with that. He taught that it's okay to eat food sacrificed to idols. And they were described as really the shameless libertarians of the day. And they were based upon really the Gnostic system that John wrote in 1 John, 2 John, where he confronted where the Gnostics, what are the great systems that they had about Jesus? That Jesus wasn't really a man. He didn't come to the earth, but he was more of a phantom. And when he walked upon the earth, you ever seen him? He just never left footprints about him. And that's kind of, the Gnostics had these strange thoughts and ideas, and they lived in the caves in the southern part of Israel, up there by down by the Dead Sea. And their lives was really unrestrained, indulgent, these fellas. And Paul here is telling us that, you know, that they were commended because they didn't allow that within the fellowship. You know, they didn't do this. And we also see in verse 2, he commend them for their dedication to the work of the Lord. He says, I know thy works and labor and patience. Dedicated, dedicated people. There's something about dedication. You know, your heart's been touched and you want to serve and you want to do things. Like I said, we have people that are dedicated helping me with running the word for today. I can't do it. So I need dedicated people to do it, and they're willing just to give up their time to serve the Lord and do whatever they can do to get the word of God out. And then secondly, we see he also commends them for their discernment. I know thy works of the Lord, how he goes on in the second part of verse 2, and how thou canst not bear them which are evil, and hast tried them who say that they're apostles and are not, and has found them liars. They had a discerning spirit. You ever have it when you listen to somebody or somebody say something, and all of a sudden your spirit goes, I don't think so. That's discernment. God gives us that discerning spirit because you're his sheep and you know the Lord's voice and you know when he speaks what he sounds like and what the word of God sounds like. Paul also writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 13. He talks about some of these guys. For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into the apostles of Christ. I like that. They're deceitful workers, but they come across as charlatans, acting like they're apostles. It no marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. He says this is no big deal. The one he's following is Satan, and he transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers, notice that he's saying these are his ministers, Satan's ministers, also be transformed as ministers of righteousness, who end shall be accorded to their works. Also in Matthew chapter 6, speaking about the same thing, we read in verse 21, not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father. Notice, the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? In thy name has cast out devils, and in thy name have we done many works. Again, I've done all the things that I look like I'm playing the part. But then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. And then, and not only he commends them for their devotion to the Lord, being faithful in the work of the Lord, and he tells us, he commends them for their devotion. Thou hast borne and hast patient for my name's sake, says the Lord, and has not fainted. A couple of verses you might want to look up with that is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58, and Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. And I think it's so beautiful that we can learn these things and we can study these things, that God wants us to be patient for his name's sake, that we follow the Lord. And then, as we mentioned earlier, he commends them for their decision regards the deeds of the Nicolaitans. And so we see this. First, we saw the central control of Jesus Christ. Then we saw the commendation that Jesus gives to the church. And thirdly, we see the concerns that Jesus Christ has for his church. Notice in verse 4, he says, the concern that he had for his church, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. So the concern that he had, nevertheless, is the Greek word Allah in verse 4. It's more just like a casual concern, but it's a great conflict when somebody has that you're really concerned about an individual. They're commended greatly for their efforts or their loyalties. The problem is very serious. The very serious thing is really their lack of love, an emphasis of work. He says, thou hast left, verse 4. It does not say that he had lost it, their first love. They actually left it. That requires our will in really setting our priority. Is our priority is to love Jesus each and every day? And really what we're seeing here, our good works don't necessarily demonstrate that we have Jesus first within our lives. Remember, it was Jesus said that seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, to put him as top priority within our lives to please him each and every day. He says where they had left their first love, what are the things that you might consider that they left? When some people do leave, the love for other believers. There's sometimes, somebody's having a hard time and they say something within a fellowship and they get mad and they leave. they kind of pout and they go out the door. We've had some people go pout and go out the door because they didn't like the way other people were treating people. And he says, "Where we need to love, we need to have love for other believers." John chapter 13, verse 34, he says, "A new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another." And I love this. He says, "As I have loved you." And so our commandment is we need to always ask ourselves, when somebody's unseemly, how would Jesus love them? He would love them totally, completely. And that's why he went to the cross, because of their shortcomings. And so we're to love them as others have loved them. I mean, as God has loved us. By this, they should know that you're my disciples. They should know, not because you're really nice to people that are nice to you. He says, that's easy to do. The heathens even do that. But you're nice and you love the people that are having a bad couple months. Maybe they got medical problems. Maybe they have financial problems. Maybe they're stressing all night long. The second thing that they could leave is love for the second coming of Jesus Christ. This troubles me. I don't know why, what it is, that somewhere along the line that the body of Christ isn't saying Maranatha very much anymore. They've lost track that Jesus Christ could come back at any time. They would say to me, "Terry, well, I've been asking and interviewed a few times, and what was it like during the Jesus People revival in the 70s? And I tell them that, you know, and I know, very careful not to talk about Pastor Chuck, because Chuck wouldn't like that. But what the Holy Spirit was saying to the church at that time, and one of the things that we were saying to each other, we would raise up our hands and say one way, and that one way symbolized Maranatha, the Lord's coming, look up. We'd have bumper stickers on our cars. We would, you know, have different things that we would see, but they would lose the love for the coming of Jesus Christ. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, he says, "Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me in that day, and not to me only, but all them which also that love his appearing." Those who love the fact that Jesus Christ can come back at any moment or any time. The third thing that we could see that they would leave, that they had left, is love for the world or non-believers. They no longer had this great love to reach the lost. Well, I don't believe that Jesus Christ could come back any time. I'm kind of believing it could be a mid-trib or post-trib, and so I got to just get along with social things, and they no longer have a passion that if Jesus Christ comes back today, tomorrow, or next week, that friend of yours, that aunt, uncle, or relatives, if they're not a believer, they're not going with us. They lose the passion for the Lord's coming back, and we lose our love for non-believers. Jesus said about God, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." That's what it's all about. That whosoever believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You know, if you tell people about it, you say, "Well, I told my uncle about it," and he says, "Get away from me." I just would look at him and say, "Well, go find another way to tell him the same thing." Until they finally break, right? Until they finally say yes to Jesus. And the fourth thing, there's more, but I think it's important, is the love for the Lord himself. His priorities, isn't that what we've been talking about? In Matthew chapter 22, we read in verse 34, "But when the Pharisees had heard what he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, saying, 'Master, what's the great commandment in the law?' And Jesus said unto them, 'Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, with all thy soul, with all thine mind.' He says, 'This is the first and great commandment. The second is like unto them, Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the laws of the and the prophets. Like I said, priorities, Jesus had dropped down. The fourth thing that we see is the challenge to the church in verse 5. The challenge to the church, he says in verse 5, remember therefore for when thou hast fallen. He says, repent and do thy first work. He says, and then he goes on, except thou repent. Remember. Remember the days when you first got saved. We used to be able to sing a song, I got Jesus and that's enough. The joy of serving him. He says, from where thou hast fallen, that life of emptiness, the life of no hope, the life where you don't have any direction from your life. He says, if that's you, he tells us the formula to get right with God. To the church, he says, first of all, repent. Repent. The first words that Jesus says in Mark chapter 1, repent and believe the gospel. Repent is turn around. Go back to Jesus and do thy first works of growing once again in faith. Follow in love with him. Spending time in the scriptures, waiting upon the Lord. He says, remember where thou hast fallen. He tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 4, he says, traitors and heady and high-minded, lover for pleasures more than for lovers of God. You remember what those days were? I like this heady. I've met a few of these headies lately where I got everything figured out. I don't need God in my life. And of course, then we says talks about for Demetrius had forsaken me, having loved for this present world and departed on the Thessalonica and the Galatia and so forth. And so the concern of Jesus Christ for his church. And then finally, the consequences which the church faces if it does not repent. Does not. He says, notice it says, for the church. The consequences for the church. In verse 5, remember therefore when thou hast fallen, repent and do thy works, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will remove thy candlesticks out of its place, except thou repent. On my page here, a study, I leave that blank. I left that blank here tonight where it says, and will remove thy candlestick out of its place. Because there's a lot of people who have different opinions about what that means, that you can lose your salvation, you can lose your priority, you can lose a lot with Jesus. All I read it, and I believe to remove thy candlestick out of its place, is if there is going to be a time of really emptiness without Jesus there. And he says, except thou repent. He gives that opportunity for that beautiful relationship that God wanted for the church of Ephesus. And remember, not only does this represent the church that actually was Ephesus, but it represented a period of time. It represents churches today. It also represents individuals. Individuals who are very good church goers and church doers, but they lost their priorities. Remember, we opened up with priorities, and the priority is keeping Jesus Christ first within our lives. It says, I will remove thy candlestick. God's the one that's removing out of its place. And even as it talks about those who went on into a period of trials, a period of tribulation, in order that they might look up and see Jesus again. I think there's believers that are going through unnecessary trials this day because they're not putting Jesus first within their lives. They're not experiencing the peace of God. That's all he's looking for, is that we would keep him first. He wants to bless us. Not that I think the number one thing is that he wants to bless us over and over and over, and we limit that blessings by not living for him completely and totally. It's my prayer this week that you too would look to put Jesus first, that you won't have a neglected priorities within your life. And the thing that's so beautiful, if you do, let's say if you have a bad week and something slips up and you don't have Jesus first, the beautiful thing is if you just confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Isn't God good? I think he's just trying to wake up the, shake the tree a little bit. Wake up the church. And says, make sure you keep things, you know, the first thing first. Is serve him and he will bless you. Next week, we'll move on and take another church or maybe even two churches. I haven't quite determined that. So read chapter 2 and 3 together. Then come on out and let's join Michael in worship and study God's word. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you again for your grace. Thank you for this evening that we can learn about you. Lord, this Church of Ephesus and all that they were doing, sounded like they were a very, very busy church there. There's many house churches working together, and yet they some got off kilter a little bit, and you're just reminding them of always live for you first, because you that's how you pour out your blessing upon him. We mentioned that verse, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then we forgot to say the last part, and all these things will be added unto you. You want to add and add and add and add to not only the church, but individuals. But we need to put you first within our lives. So I just pray if any of us have slipped and been out of whack this week, Lord, that we might once again return in Jesus' name.